each breath he's given.
Welcome to Hopkins Community Church. We're so glad that you've joined us this morning on this Palm Sunday. I invite you to stand as we worship our Lord today.
All our fears are God who saves us, you're worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Again, good morning. Welcome in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Today we remember that when Jesus came into Jerusalem and the crowd saw him, they gathered palm branches, they placed their cloaks in front of him, and they shouted, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And today we come into worship as well, and we do a very similar, we take a very similar posture. You don't have to take off your coats or whatever else and lay them down, but we as followers of Jesus lay our hearts down before him, recognizing once again that Christ is our King, he is our Lord, he is our Savior, and we come to submit ourselves to him, to hear from him, to listen to him. And so we too say, along with his people, "Hosanna, Lord, save us. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." It's our God, our King, who welcomes us in, gathers us into worship today, and greets us with these words, "Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ." Amen? Amen. Well, again, welcome to worship. We're so glad you're here. This morning, as we do kind of a normal greeting time, we have a couple of things for you, okay? So first of all, an invitation. If you came a little late and you're hungry right now, there is food in the multipurpose room. There are breakfast burritos, so eggs and sausage and all sorts of stuff. You are welcome to go get some because there's a lot left. So feel free to shake a hand and then go grab some food. If you're not going to go grab some food, or if you have already eaten, the question would be this. What is, if you're going out for breakfast, right, what is the one thing that you're going for at the breakfast buffet, right? What is that one thing that you're going for? Or your favorite order for breakfast food? Discuss.
You can't go get food.
Eggs and bacon. All right, just by show of hands, how many people went for the bacon first? Bacon? What's wrong? That's it? Oh, all right, well, here, I thought I was going to know that one here. Scripture says, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." Let's sing together.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift his name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come and rejoice. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Whether the sun will shine, whether the skies will rain, I know that you are good. This is the day you made. Whether in life or death, whether in joy or pain, I know the truth remains. This is the day you made.
will rejoice as we lift his name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come and rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad. Now I can walk in faith, you will protect my way. Your every work is good, this is the day you child of yours. You are the one who saves.
I am redeemed by love.
This is the day you made. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift his name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come and rejoice. We will rejoice and be glad. is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. The sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. The sun sets free. Salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor us. See, the stone is rolled away. And from the grave, and oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto me. And oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, won through your selfless love. This the power of the cross, Son of God, slain for us. What a love, what a cost, we stand for.
Thank you. Okay. We're on power again, I believe. Doesn't sound like it. Yes, there we go. As I invite the prayer team to come forward, I want to draw your attention to the listing in the bulletins, and I want us to especially, if you could intercede throughout the week and these weeks for Jenny, please do. There's a lot of detail there. She's at the refuge in Indiana. And let's just say that we are all contending for Jenny Porter. And the prayer is very, very critical. So let's take all of our needs before the Lord.
Dear Lord, thank you for this beautiful morning we come and worship you. We're so blessed we can worship you like this. We pray that you help Jenny to come back home, help her with the depression, and find you, Lord.
Lord, thank you for everyone here and everyone that can't be here this morning. Thank you for your hand over us in our community. Thank you for healing for all that need it right now, Lord. There are so many that we are thinking of. Thank you for healing mentally, emotionally, physically, and spiritually, Lord. Thank you for being with the people who are traveling for spring break this week and the upcoming weeks. Thank you that your hand of protection is upon them as they travel. Thank you for blessing them on the road and in the air. Thank you for watching the waters and just keeping an eye on everyone. Help them to find a good time, peace, and reflection in you as they travel. Thank you, Lord, for blessing everyone this week. Thank you that we find you in all that we do. Lord, thank you for entering our thoughts, our words, our actions. Lord, thank you that we may be a light to those who don't know you and that they may come to ask about you because of the way we come out into the world. We ask all these things in your name. Amen.
We want to invite our youngest members to go out to walkout worship at this time. And I would invite the rest of us, let us stand in honor of God's word. We will be looking at Matthew 2, the first 12 verses. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out for them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God truly stands forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, everyone. Wow, that was bad. Yeah, good morning, everyone. I'll try that again. Ate too many breakfast burritos back there, huh? You're now in a food coma. All right, we'll try and wake you up a little bit. So we have today the collision again of Christmas and Easter. This is pretty awesome. This doesn't happen regularly, right? We normally hear Luke 2 or Matthew 2 at Christmas, but in our sermon series, we find ourselves here today, specifically focusing on seeking the king and this story. Hi, Kira. I love you. I'm up here. Yep, I'm not sitting with you today. So we have this story of seeking the king from the Christmas story, but it's also Palm Sunday today. And so what I want us to think about is both seeking and responding. And so we're going to look at the Magi, how they seek and respond. We're going to look at King Herod, how he seeks and responds. Also Simeon and Anna. And then we're going to talk about the triumphal entry of Jesus on Palm Sunday. So here we go. First, the Magi come seeking, right? What does it say in verse 2? Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose, and we have come to worship him. So the Magi come seeking, and our best guess is that they come from the east, likely Babylon or Persia. And so the rough estimate is that it was about 1,000 miles, give or take, for them to journey, which would have taken them several months, even over a year, right? This is why we get the timeline of when Herod asks them how long, when did the star, and he eventually decides to kill all of the male 2 years old and younger. So it could have taken them somewhere up to 2 years by our best guesses. Okay, so they come seeking. They travel a long ways over a long period of time. Okay, I want you to remember that, because now, in comparison, King Herod, right? Does he seek or not? Well, in verse 4, right, Herod is disturbed when he hears this in verse 3, and then in verse 4, when he called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. Right, so in some, he's a bit curious, right? Like, he's seeking, he wants to know, maybe for different reasons, obviously. But then, when he hears where the king is to be born, Bethlehem, he sends the Magi to Bethlehem because Herod wants to go and worship him, right? And we know from the end of the story, that's not what he wants to do at all. But in some sense, he is seeking, but I want you to catch the comparison. Bethlehem is only 5 or 6 miles away from Jerusalem, where King Herod is, which would have taken a couple of hours. Do you find it odd that Herod doesn't just go there himself? It's not that far. So he's curious, but he's not curious enough to go travel a couple of hours, where the Magi have been traveling for months, even over a year, and a long journey. So let's compare the Magi and King Herod. The Magi were deeply despised outsiders. They were considered heathen, right? They were idolaters because they were magicians and astrologers. They studied the stars. To Israel and the early church, they would have been the least deserving guests at the birthday party of Jesus. And yet, everyone would have known they were in town, right? You don't just sneak into town with an entourage, potentially on camels and hauling a bunch of stuff, and get a face-to-face showing with the king. Like, that doesn't happen quietly. So everyone would have known they were in town, right? They were a big deal since they got to talk with King Herod. Pause. It's an interesting side note. Matthew's gospel is the only one that records the story of the Magi, or the wise men. And I think you'll find this fascinating. So Matthew starts his gospel right here at Christmas with an invitation to the nations, right? He's talking, he includes the wise men because it's an outsider, people from other nations that come to celebrate Jesus. It's an invitation of the nations. And then how does Matthew's gospel end? With the Great Commission, to go out to all the nations. It's a fascinating beginning and an ending point for Matthew. It's pretty cool. So Herod is an insider, right? He's powerful. He has the chief priests and the rulers of the law at his disposal at any time. He is able to know whatever he wants to know whenever he wants. But he has zero intention to actually go and worship, right? We know that's clear from the end of the story. Whereas the Magi are coming to worship. And so the Magi respond to God's word, right? So they come to Jerusalem, and then King Herod calls the chief priests, teachers, rule of the law. Where is the king to be born? They hear the word of God from Micah, right? Bethlehem. The Magi respond and go to Bethlehem, and King Herod sits at home, not curious enough to go a couple hours, right? He's content to send the Magi. It's also fascinating, if you think about this, that the leadership of the people of God, right, the chief priests, the rulers, the teachers of the law, they're also not curious enough to travel a couple hours. These are the promises from the Old Testament that God had given to these people. And they're still not willing to walk a couple of hours and see for themselves. But it is the outsiders, the pagans, those who are despised, that they have the courage to go and seek and find and go to Bethlehem. So we have the seeking, and now let's look at how they respond. Okay, so the Magi, if you're still in Matthew 2 in front of you, in verse 10, when they see the star, they were overjoyed. And then in verse 11, once they came to the house, they saw the child, they bowed down and worshiped him. And then they open their treasures and present to him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. They give him gifts. Okay, so they're filled with joy. That's the response. And then they're willing to give of their treasures. Contrast that with King Herod. Right, if you go back to verse 3, right when the Magi come, when King Herod hears this question, where's the one who's been born king of the Jews, he is disturbed. Right, and all of Jerusalem is disturbed with him. And then towards the end of the story, verse 16, right, when Herod realized he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious, and he gave orders to kill all of the boys in Bethlehem who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi. So look at the difference in the response. The Magi, or the wise men, come in faith. Right? They have faith that the star is going to lead them to this king of the Jews. Whereas King Herod comes in rebellion, right? He hears that there's another king, which means he's in trouble because he's right now the king, and he rebels. And so I wonder, what do we learn from the Magi and King Herod in the difference in how they seek God, the king, and how they respond, right? Because Herod, right, if someone else is king, then he's not. And that's a raw human reaction that I think, if we're honest, we all have. Right? Because if we have to give up control and say Jesus is Lord and King, that means that we're not Lord and King, and we're not in control either. And so, you know I like songs. So here's a song that I think relates to the Magi and their journey. It's a classic. I think you'll love it.
I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. I travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere.
All right, so the Magi, come on, that's funny. Johnny Cash, all right, need a little humor, that's good, right? Classic Johnny. The Magi have traveled everywhere, right? Thousands of miles, several months, over a year. They serve to us as an encouragement, right? Based on the song, right? We've been everywhere. No matter where you've been in your life, no matter how far away you've traveled from God, God's grace still summons you and says, come back. I will come to you. I will rescue you. I will redeem you. Like, no matter how far away you felt from God, God is there waiting for you. And so the Magi serve as an encouragement to us, right? If we listen to God's word, like the Magi did, and go in faith to Bethlehem like they did, us too need to go and step out in faith in our daily lives. We will meet and worship Jesus. We will find him there. And then we will give him our gifts, give him our lives, and then too, like the Magi, go back home a different way. Because when you meet Jesus, your life has changed and your life is different. And so the Magi are an encouragement to us to continue seeking. No matter how far away you felt from God, or you are right now currently from God, keep seeking, keep following, keep responding. And then Herod. Herod, on the other hand, serves as a warning, right? Because Herod, I don't know if you caught this, but Herod hears the same scripture the Magi do. It's read in the presence of all of them. So Herod has a chance, right? Bethlehem, the word Bethlehem is God's invitation to Herod as much as it is to the Magi. Herod hears it and does not pursue it. And so Herod is a warning of what can happen to us when we reject God's grace. When we hear God's word and we find ways to resist it, we find excuses to not follow what God's word tells us to do. And in doing so, like Herod, we will not only hurt ourselves, but we will also hurt innocent people all around us. And I think if we're really honest with ourselves, Herod, though he died a long time ago, the spirit of Herod lives on in every one of us. Exaggerated ambitions, self-centeredness, greed, desire for fame, holding a grudge against God, and being insensitive towards other humans. There are two kings at odds in this world, and they're in all of us, Herod and Jesus Christ. Martin Luther puts it this way: our flesh in itself is corrupt and inclined to evil, even after we accept and believe in God's word. And so the call is to accept and believe God's word. Don't reject it like Herod did. All right, that's the Magi in a handful of minutes. Magi and Herod, the difference in their seeking and responding. And so now I invite you to pop over to Luke 2, another account of the Christmas story, and we're going to look at the seeking and responding from both Simeon and Anna. We're going to pick it up at verse 25 in Luke 2. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. When the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel." All right, so here we have Simeon responding, seeking and responding, right? He's seeking, he's known as a devout worshiper. And how does he respond when he sees Jesus? He knows Jesus is God's salvation. He proclaims Jesus to be a light to the Gentiles. Simeon is filled with joy and also peace, right? God promised him he wouldn't die until he saw the Messiah. Now he's seen him. He's ready. He's filled with peace knowing that Jesus has come. And now, a couple verses later, Anna. Verse 36, there was a prophet, Anna, and then starting in 37, she never left the temple, but worshiped night and day, fasting and praying. Coming up to them at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Israel. Right? So Anna, also seeking, is a devout worshiper. How does she respond? Right? Full of thanks. Thankful to God. She's filled with joy, finding fulfillment that the Messiah has come. And then she preaches to the crowd, right? This is the Messiah, the Lord. This is Israel's coming redemption. So as we look at both Simeon and Anna, we see again some common themes in their seeking God daily and worshiping, and then how they respond when they meet Jesus. These are two great examples of not only seeking God daily through their worship at the temple, but also responding to the king when they encounter Jesus. So that's the Christmas story, right? Magi, King Herod, Simeon, and Anna, how they were seeking, how they're responding. And now, let's take those same themes of seeking and responding and now look at Palm Sunday, because it is, in fact, Palm Sunday today. So you can flip over to Matthew 21, verse 1. I'll also have this one on the screen. This is Matthew's account of the servant king's entry into Jerusalem. So Matthew 21, starting at verse 1. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." So this passage in all four gospel accounts often gets to referred as the triumphal entry. But let's be clear. This is no triumphal entry. This is a modest Messiah. Jesus enters on a lowly donkey, showing his full humanity. What kind of ruler, what kind of lord, what kind of king would be riding on a humble donkey and not on a horse surrounded by a cavalry of soldiers? Remember, for Matthew, Jesus is the long-anticipated Messiah. He's the King of Kings and the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies. So Matthew is specifically interested here in the fulfillment of the prophecy from Zechariah 9, verse 9. "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Now, did you catch what phrase Matthew leaves out in Matthew's account? He says all of this, except he doesn't include righteous and victorious, which in some other translations is triumphant and victorious. Why does he leave that out? Matthew wants to emphasize Jesus, his humble and ordinary provisions for this historic entry. Right? There's no heralds, there's no trumpets, there's no chariots, there's no prancing horses. He comes quietly on a donkey, so that the poorest of all people may not be discouraged in approaching him. Right? Who feels comfortable approaching a king up on a horse surrounded by soldiers? Much more likely to approach a king riding on a donkey at people's level. Jesus is the humble king, the modest king, the lowly king, and the servant king. So perhaps the question that the whole city asks, that only Matthew records in his gospel account, you'll only find this question in Matthew from the crowds. Who is this? Right? And the responses are recorded, right? The crowds say, Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth. The crowds are also saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. In Luke's account, Luke 19, the crowds are joyfully praising God for all the miracles that they had seen. And they say, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. What did the Pharisees do in Luke? Teacher, rebuke your disciples, right? Keep them quiet. So the question that the crowds ask, I think, applies to us today, right? Who is this? Or maybe put differently, if we want to rephrase it, who is the King of your life? And I think most of us know the Sunday school answer that's always correct, right? Jesus, right? Who's the King of your life? Jesus. That's always the winning answer in Sunday school. Right? I think we know that in our heads. Now the question is, how does your heart line up with your head? How do your desires line up? How do your actions line up with who is the King of your life? If it's Jesus, everything should line up with that. Where we spend our money, how we spend our time, the things we say. And so I wonder, the Jews in Jesus' day, so many of them missed who Jesus was. They were looking for a king that was a soldier, a king that was a warrior, a high and mighty ruler to overthrow the Roman government and lead them. But you won't find that in Jesus. They didn't find it in Jesus. You can find that in other people in our society. But you won't find it in Jesus. And so many of the Jews missed it. And so I don't want us to miss that today. Who is Jesus? Pastor Alistair Begg puts it this way in a sermon that he shared. Israel's kings, whether it was Saul or David or Solomon, even the best of them, flunked out and left the people saying, well, we had thought that a king would be an answer. And in the succession program, they went for a little while, and it seemed to be good, but then they had to come up with somebody else. They give the Democrats a shot at it. Then they give the Republicans a shot at it. Then they gave them another one, and then it went back to the Democrats, and then it went somewhere else. Now, of course, there's not Democrats or Republicans in the Bible, but you get my point. And eventually, when it was all said and done, no one was any further forward than when they had started the program. By the end of it, everyone did what was right in their own eyes. So they said, well, let's try it again. Let's have a king. Maybe a king is the answer. But then the succession plan leaves them with nothing at the end of it, except to find themselves saying, there must be something better than this. Or actually, there must be someone better than this. Psalm 146 reminds us, do not put your trust in princes, in human beings who cannot save. When their spirit departs, they return to the ground on that day, very day, their plans come to nothing. Blessed are those whose help is in the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God. I think we know we can't put our trust in human beings or leaders in our day. It hasn't worked ever since time began. And so if we can't place our trust in leaders or human beings, can we place our trust in things, the things of this world or ideas? And I think if we do, you'll find the words to this timeless song to be true. Bonus, there's two songs today. You two, so good, right? All of us are looking. All of us are seeking. The question is, who or what are you seeking? Right? Who is the king of your life? And then the next follow-up question is, who or what are you seeking? Because if you're placing your hope or your trust or you're seeking assurance or satisfaction or comfort in the things of this world, I don't think you're going to find what you're looking for. Right? The number of friends you have on social media, the grades you get in school, your athletic ability or musical ability or theater ability or a political party or whoever the next president is going to be or any new laws that get signed or how much money you make in a year, or the next job promotion that you're striving for, none of these things are going to save you. And they're not going to bring you satisfaction. You won't find whatever you're looking for. They won't save you. But you know who will save you? It's Jesus. Jesus says, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life must lose it. And whoever loses their life for me will find it. What good will it be to gain the whole world and forfeit your soul? So seek Jesus. Jesus is the only one that's going to save you. You won't find what you're looking for in anything or anyone else in this world. And so I want to offer three ways to respond. Okay, seeking and responding. For seeking Jesus, here are three ways we might respond. And the first involves answering this question. Are you willing to surrender to Jesus? Right, are you willing to give up control of your life and follow Jesus? Or do you want to be the king and in control of your own life, much like Herod, right? Content with everything you have, disinterested in the word of God, even willing to reject what the word of God tells you, especially when it pushes you out of your comfort zone to live differently, right? And are you willing to take your self-centeredness out on others? So that's a hard question. Right? Are you willing to surrender to Jesus? Or do you still want to be the king of your own life? Secondly, what will it take for you to seek Jesus, the humble king? Right? Not the soldier king, not the military king, not the warrior king, or even an earthly king, but the servant king. Right, we're stepping into Holy Week, the servant king who is willing to suffer and die on the cross for you and for me, the king who saves us from our sins, the one we are begging to, the one we are crying out to, the one we are praying to, saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, which means save us, please. Right? Save us. Don't miss out like so many of the Jews did. Don't miss out on who Jesus actually is, the humble servant king. And then how might we respond to Jesus? With a life of worship, right? The Magi did it. Simeon did it. Anna did it. They encountered Jesus and they worshiped him. Worship is at the heart of discipleship. Apostle Peter says this, "Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God." You can't just think your way to worship. You have to live it out. Right? We worship what we love. So people will know who we love by how we worship. They'll know who we love by how we live. There's no middle ground. Either Jesus is Lord and King and you live accordingly, or Jesus is not Lord and King and you live accordingly. Right? You're either hot or you're cold, as we learn in Revelation 3. Right? There's no option for half in, half out, lukewarm followers of Jesus. We worship what we love. People will know who we are following, who we are worshiping, by how we are living our lives. So to land the plane here, it's a great quote from C.S. Lewis from Mere Christianity. He puts it this way, "I'm trying here to prevent anyone from saying the really foolish thing that people often say about him, Jesus. I'm ready to accept Jesus as a great moral teacher, but I don't accept his claim to be God." Have you heard that one out there before, right? Jesus is a great moral teacher. That is the one thing we must not say. A man who is merely a man and said the sort of things Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic on a level with a man who says he is a poached egg, or else he would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. You can shut him up for a fool, you can spit at him and kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. Jesus is either Lord or he's a lunatic and a liar. There's no middle ground. So is Jesus the king of your life? If he's not, he wants to be. Will you let him be the king of your life? Not as some version of the best earthly king that we follow, but as the ultimate servant king. The one who died on the cross and rose again for your salvation, which we'll celebrate this week on Maundy Thursday and Easter Sunday. So I want to challenge you and leave you with this week. Seek Jesus. Seek Jesus the King. Not whatever else or version of the King you want Jesus to be. Seek Jesus the Servant King. The one who's willing to die for you. That's someone worth following. Seek Jesus the King, and then respond. Right? Respond to Jesus the King like the Magi did, like Simeon did, like Anna did. Respond with a life of worship. And live your life in such a way so that when people see you and see your good deeds, they want to follow Jesus. Just like you. Seek and respond to Jesus. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, let's pray. Loving God, we are grateful for the opportunity to worship you here this morning, to give you all of the glory and all of the praise. Together in a community of people that we love. Thank you for good food this morning before the worship service. Thank you for every person here. And we believe that no one is here by accident. Help your word to convict us to live differently. As hard as it is to surrender control, help us to surrender the control of our lives over to you, to live in such a way that reflects you, to be your light to everyone we meet, to share your love with people who we don't even like. Help us to befriend those who are on the outside, those who are on the margins, those who are different from us, and invite them in to our lives. Lord, as we step into Holy Week and we're mindful of what you went through on the cross for us and for our salvation and how you rose again, help us to reflect on that and to be full of gratitude for how you demonstrated what it means to be a servant king, what it means to be the suffering servant, that you were willing to go to the cross and die for us so that we might have life. God, we're so thankful for that gift and the gift of grace that you give to us. Help us to live this week in such a way that points people to you. All this we do and say in the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. Awesome. Yeah. Just a couple of quick announcements. I'm going to invite the praise team to come forward as they do. Just a couple of things you can check out in the bulletin if you have one in front of you. If not, just kind of to be aware, there's coffee and cookies. There are donuts here as well after church this morning, so feel free to grab one. There's lots of goodies. Hang out. We'd love to get to know you, talk a little bit more with you and stuff like that. So again, it's always great to be together. Tonight there is high school youth group. After church today, also there is the final session of Making Life Disciples here in the sanctuary. So come for that. We're going to talk about next steps too. What does it mean for us to move on from this into whatever God has in store for us as a church? So next week, obviously, is Easter. We have a Monday-Thursday service on Thursday evening at 6 o'clock, and Easter service on Sunday, same time, same place. We're looking forward to celebrating that great day of days, the day that Jesus rose again from the dead. And so Tuesday is there's a Bible study in the evening, and Rubies and Cadets meets as well. And then just a kind of a note, and this is kind of actually more of a note from me. You can see right at the beginning of the announcements here, as we move into April, past Easter, we are going to be having some conversations about church membership. Now, if you know me, you know that the word member is one that I have constantly and consistently railed against as a pastor, because I do not like the exclusivity and the kind of past idea of what it has meant. Like, I'm in and you're out and so on and so forth. And what it's mean, right? I want to make sure that I have my stamp of approval that I'm a church member, so I'm good to go. We're going to talk about what the Bible says about church membership. And we're going to talk about what the Bible implies about church membership, the very direct teachings that it gives. And we're going to work as a church to model that in the way that we think about church membership, whatever that means. All right, we're in a new denomination, and they don't track membership in the way that it used to be anyways. And so what does it mean? Like, what does that mean for us? And what does it mean to belong first to Christ, right? Because that's the most important thing. What does it mean to confess Christ as your Lord and King, and have that be the primary part of your life? And then what does that mean for you and for us as a church, as we belong to the body of Christ, and as Scripture says, as we are each members of it? So we're going to talk a lot about that, and it's going to be coming up in April. It's going to be interesting. This is new exploration for me. It's new exploration for us, and I'm excited to look at that together as a church. And we're going to be doing that as we lead up to Profession of Faith Sunday, which is at the end of April too. So those are the things that are kind of going on. You can see a few more other things too. Mark your calendars for one other thing. This is in May, so this is, I don't know how many of you are that far down your calendar line at this point in time. You're probably just hoping to get to spring break at this point. But if you're thinking along the lines down the way, May 18, so it's like the third Saturday in May, we are doing the annual Hopkins Community Cleanup again. That's the dumpster day here in the village where, you know, people are throwing all the stuff away and we get to kind of help with the help them with that. So it's an awesome opportunity for us to serve the Hopkins community. It's an awesome opportunity for us to be present and in something that is going on in the village. So just mark your calendars for that. There'll be a sign up later on as well. Just an exciting opportunity again to minister to this community. So I'm going to invite you to stand. Well, that's funny. I have a daughter that has a birthday today too. Hey, Tally Larman. Raise your hand. I'm proud. Happy birthday. Nobody gets a donut until Tally gets a donut. There you go. I see the Reed boys back there too, so you best hurry. Otherwise, and Quinn, yeah, sorry, no, I'm just kidding. Happy birthday. It's awesome. We celebrate you, celebrate God's faithfulness in your life today as well. So we go into a new week, God goes with us, right? This is the sort of the week of weeks, really, for us as followers of Jesus. This is the event that the church has celebrated exclusively throughout the entirety of its existence, that Jesus Christ came, that he suffered and died, and that he rose again from the dead. So go into this week, not as just another week, but mindful of what it is that we are celebrating, mindful of who Jesus is, and mindful of what it means to crown him as king of your life. And as you go, know that you do not go alone, but know that the word of God dwells in you richly. Know that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit is ours now and always. Amen? Amen. We're going to sing one more song called King of Kings.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope and without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To you came the word from a throne of endless glory. Blood And in His name, in His freedom, I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.